was just hanging in sweet time.
There we go. Okay, thanks everybody for coming this afternoon for Christian's presentation. I'm Steve Silver. I'm the instructor for BTM 365 History of the Bible in English. I'm Christian's a student in that class. Part of our study in that class was a brief look at sort of the formation of the Bible itself before we understood how it was translated into English. We wanted to know what it was and where it came from. Out of that, Christian developed an interest in one part of that story of the formation of what we now know as the Bible. And so as part of an honors contract, an honors credit for this course, she's done some research on that and is going to present that to us today. So, over to Christian.
For your benefit, I have provided a handout that has terms that you'll be hearing in this presentation, along with references I will be reading. So if I say something that sounds a little funny, just take a look at the paper. As part of the Christian faith, we deal with a lot of balances between two extremes, good and evil, angels, demons. These certain extremes where you're either on one side or the other. So in order to have orthodoxy, you must also have heresy. And that is the discussion that we're going to be engaging in, is about heresy, which means we may be discussing things that, as Christians, is frankly uncomfortable with us. All I ask is that you hear me out, and if after the presentation you really don't like what I say, then we can go up to the quad, where I'm sure the scholars on this half of the room would be more than happy to show you the steps of burning someone. In order to understand the Gnostic Gospels, we need to look at what we know about them. By show of hands, how many of you have either read or watch the film The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown? Quite a few of us. Do you remember the part where Robert Langdon and Sophie Naveau go on a mad dash to Chateau Villette, where they meet with one of Langdon's colleagues, Sir Keating, and he starts talking about the Council of Nicaea and how they had debated gospels, which ones were valid, which ones were not, and then started reading out of the ones that were rejected at the Council of Nicaea. He specifically read from the Gospel of Mary Magdalene and the Gospel of Philip. One thing I would like to make clear, seeing how this is a story with which we are familiar, is Keating was wrong. The Council of Nicaea had a completely different purpose. Yes, it was to discuss heresy, particularly the heresy caused by Arius, who, while was something of a Gnostic, had nothing to do with these Gospels. So, unfortunately, as with a lot of Dan Brown's writing, this part was complete and total fiction. Now, here are the Gospels we are all familiar with. This is the official canon for the New Testament. We have what are called the Synoptic Gospels, which are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They are called the Synoptic Gospels because they have very similar stories, very similar narrative biography, and they tell the story of the birth, ministry, and death of Christ. John is not part of the Synoptic Gospels, but his gospel plays a huge part because he takes the story from the viewpoint of John the Beloved, the disciple that Christ loved above all others. And he tells the story in greater details, especially the crucifixion and the resurrection. Now, here are the Gnostic Gospels. The collection of the Gnostic Gospels are more commonly known as the Nagamati. It has approximately 13 codices, or leather-bound books, that contain 52 Gospels. So essentially 12 books with 8 leaves of the 13th. And the best-known Gospels from the Nagamati are the Gospel of Thomas, the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, and the Gospel of Judas. Like with the Gospel of John and the Synoptic Gospels, the Gospel of Judas was not part of the Nag Hammadi. It's actually a Gnostic Gospel that has been around for many centuries. It was written in the Coptic language and has been majoritatively, if not widely accepted by scholars and historians as a Gnostic Gospel. And these manuscripts date back between the 2nd and 4th century, depending on which Gospel you're looking at. The reason why it is called the Nag Hammadi is because of its location. It was discovered deep in the caves near Nag Hammadi, Egypt. They were called the Jabal HaTarif Caves. They were discovered in December of 1945 by two brothers, Muhammad and Khalif Ali of the Al-Saman clan. They were what you would expect in the river region. They were farmers. They belonged to a small village. And they were digging in the caves looking for things to sell so that they could make a living. But after a dispute with his brother, Muhammad gave the codices to the local Coptic priest, Basilius Abd al-Masi. And he had the codices for a while, but they eventually made rounds on the black market before being taken to a museum in Cairo, where they were finally brought to public attention. However, as you can imagine, when the Nag Hammadi documents were translated, scholars noticed some very peculiar issues with those particular Gospels. The first problem is they were written in the 2nd to 3rd century, as opposed to the Synoptic Gospels that were written in the 1st century. This is very important because, for historians, there are two what we would call deadly sins. The sin of anachronism, which is taking a particular period of time and putting it in another period where it doesn't belong. And the sin of presentism, which is interpreting something in the past with the lenses of the current time period. In this case, it's reading history backwards instead of forwards. And the problem with the Gnostic Gospels were that they were telling stories about Christ, but they were being told through the lens of someone who already knew what the end of the story was. Another issue was that the authorship was dubious. There are claims to whoever wrote these Gospels, but they are not confirmed. There is no way to confirm. And so there is no way to prove who wrote them. While most scholars accept that for the Synoptic Gospels, they were written by who people claim have written them. Though again, with the Gospel of John, there is still a little bit of debate on who wrote that one. A huge issue had to do with the Christology of the Gnostic Gospels. The Gnostic Gospels paint Jesus in a different light than the Synoptic Gospels, that he was an imperfect man, that he was not divine, that he married, had a family. And one of the other biggest issues is that, according to the Gospel of Thomas, Jesus isn't the gateway to heaven. Whereas, as we are familiar, Jesus was divine both as a man and after the resurrection. He is the route to salvation, and he was the Son of God, despite what Teabing may have argued. The Gnostic Gospels were a collection of stories, yes, but they're also mostly a book of quotes. Different sayings that Jesus supposedly said, but there's no real context to it, there's no real placement to it. It's almost like someone took random quotes, put it together, and made it into a gospel. Whereas the Synoptic Gospels is a biography of Jesus. And again, as I said, Teabing was wrong. The Gnostic Gospels were rejected as heresy in the First Council of Constantinople in 389 CE, also known as Common Era. And as for the Synoptic Gospels, they were accepted as canon at the Council of Carthage a few years later. So, quite a few years after the Council of Nicaea. First, we're going to look at the Gospel of Judas, which you will find in your handout. Judas said, "Master, could it be that my seed is under the control of the rulers?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Come that I, but that you will grieve much when you see the kingdom in all of its generation." When he heard this, Judas said to him, "What good is it that I have received it? For you have set me apart for that generation." Jesus answered and said, "You will become the 13th, and you will be cursed by the other generations, and you will come to rule over them. In the last days, they will curse your ascent to the holy generation." Quite a statement for Judas, isn't it? Here are the problems. The Gospel of Judas has been considered inaccurate and unreliable, given the records that have existed about Judas, especially the fact that the Gospel of Judas does depict him in more favorable terms than you will find in the Gospels. It's basically Judas's story from someone who's looking at it from his point of view. And the claim is that instead of Judas going to the Pharisees asking how much will you pay for me to betray him, it was the other way around. Jesus pulled Judas aside and commanded him to betray him. It also blames God for the evil in the world because the world rejected God's sovereignty. Basically, the only reason why there could be evil in the world is because God was responsible for it. It was also written, as I said, much later than the Synoptic Gospels in the mid-early 2nd century. So what does the Synoptic Gospels have to say for this story? From Matthew 26, verses 20 to 25 in the New Revised Standard Version, it says, "When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, 'Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me.' And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, 'Surely not I, Lord.' He answered, 'The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed.' It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so." So if we were to take a look at the words used, particularly by Jesus, to talk about whoever betrayed him, it's kind of a stretch to think that Jesus would have been okay with Judas's decision, let alone tell him, "I want you to do this." And then we have the infancy gospel of Thomas. Now, how many of us have read through the Gospels and wish that there had been a few more details about Christ when he was a child? I know I certainly had questions and curiosities. The infancy gospel of Thomas was an attempt to kind of fill in the plot holes, so to speak. However, we will quickly see why the infancy gospel of Thomas was quite problematic. A child ran and dashed against his shoulder. And Jesus was provoked and said unto him, Thou shalt not finish thy course. And immediately he fell down and died. But certain, when they saw what was done, said, Whence was this young child born? For that every word of his is an accomplished work. And the parents of him that was dead came unto Joseph and blamed him, saying, Thou hast such a child, canst not dwell with us in the village, or do thou teach him to bless and not to curse, for he slayeth our children. The story continues by telling us that Joseph had pulled Jesus aside, boxed his ear, and began scolding him. In response, Jesus turned to those who were accusing him and struck them blind before he turned back to Joseph and told him that he would be wise not to cause Jesus to become very angry with him. Now, given that description of Jesus, there's a few things that probably sound a little unusual and flat out disturbing. Again, this was an attempt to fill in the details of Jesus' childhood. However, it was considered highly insulting to Jesus' character as a boy. Given what we do know of his childhood, this isn't exactly what we read about. It also likens Jesus as similar to a trickster god, say Loki for the Norse mythology, or Set, or any other mischievous or malevolent god in any mythology, rather than the New Testament and risen Christ. And this was one of the latest gospels that was written in the 5th century. So let us turn to the Gospel of Luke, the part of the New Testament that does tell us a little bit about Christ. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Now every year his parent went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw them, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety. He said to them, Why were you searching for me? Did you not know I must be in my father's house? But they did not understand what was said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart, and Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. So the New Testament shows us that Christ was, while quite young, very wise, obedient to his parents, basically all we would expect for a Messiah, as opposed to the infancy gospel of Thomas, who, frankly, kind of makes Jesus look like a sick little psychopath, doesn't it? And then we have the third and the most quoted Gnostic gospel, the Gospel of Thomas. These are the hidden words that the living Jesus spoke and that Didymus Judas Thomas wrote down. And he said, Whoever finds the meanings of these words will not taste death. The Gospel of Thomas was written no earlier than the mid-second century. So again, a couple of centuries past the Synoptic Gospels. It also borrows the language of Luke. I actually pulled out my Bible as well as the Gospel of Thomas, and I very quickly pinpointed chunks of Luke within the quotes gathered in the Gospel of Thomas. And what is known in those quotes depicts Jesus as a wild and wise traveling teacher. Basically the weird guy you would see strolling down the street with a sign saying the end is near, instead of a wise teacher and healer, as you would see in the Synoptic Gospels. So again, it depicts Christ as being more human than divine. It also goes against what we as the church believes is the route to heaven. For us, we believe that we achieve salvation through the acceptance of Jesus Christ, whereas in the Gospel of Thomas, by gaining knowledge, especially higher hidden knowledge and wisdom, is the key to salvation, and not through a man. Which directly contradicts the Gospel of John 14:5-7. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." So again, we're seeing two extremes. We see the Synoptic Gospels, who make it very clear who Christ was, that he was a divine, both in flesh and after the resurrection. That as a child, he was wiser beyond his years. And he had, he was wise beyond his years, and he had love and obedience for his parents. Not what you're reading in the Gnostic Gospels. And most importantly, the Synoptic Gospels teaches that it's through Jesus Christ that we gain our salvation, as opposed to any knowledge we could possibly possess here on earth. Now, you might be wondering why I would want to devote the last 15 weeks to this subject. The reason that I have such an interest in the Gnostic Gospels is because, as someone who does value knowledge, who values education, who wants to learn as much as I can while I can, the idea of gnosis, which means knowledge, and sophia, that means wisdom, is something I find highly, highly intoxicating. It is very attractive to me. And that's the problem with heresy, is it can look attractive, but it is also dangerous. So by taking a look at new gospels, even the ones that date back from hundreds and thousands of years ago, by having an orthodoxy, by having a canon, it'll keep people, even people like me, who finds things like this appealing, on the path that God would want me to travel. Thank you.
We've got a couple minutes if there's a quick question or two. From anybody?
The methodology for dating, is that going from text and scientific research, or based on scholars' opinions of the style of writing? So the dates?
Both, because you have the manuscripts, so you can use science to find how old the paper was, how old the writing is.
Right.
They also compared it to other texts from that time period.
Okay.
So you can say both, because even on this topic, many scholars disagree with each other.
Yeah. How do you explain the divergence of approach? You know, even in some of these later later writings. But why would they diverge in these ways? Do you have any ideas on that?
Well, especially with Gnosticism, we're talking about groups of people that lived on the outskirts of where Christianity was spreading. So they were getting only bits and pieces, especially when they're out in the desert areas of the Near East compared to those who live in Jerusalem or live in Galilee. So they're getting parts of the story, but they're not getting the whole picture. And then they have, you know, people trying to fill in the gaps, which is where we get a lot of less than accurate information.
One final question?
Just one question. I mean, clearly in these Gospels, Jesus appears quite different than in the canonical Gospels. Does he appear similar from one Gnostic Gospel to another? I mean, in the infancy Gospel of Thomas, he's the divine breath. But in the other Gospel, other Gnostic Gospels, does he appear the same kind of, in the same kind of way?
No, you're looking at several different versions of Jesus when you go from one Gospel to the other. Because in the Gospel of Thomas, you don't see him as a raving psychopath. You see him as a very weird guy who speaks in riddles.
Okay.
Which I suppose isn't too far away from the Synoptic Gospel.
So it's not only different from the Synoptic Gospels in John, but it's different from each other.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, thank you all for coming. Thank you, Christian, for your work and for your presentation.